significance of Samantabhadra. How many of you have heard this name? Samantabhadra, Puxian Pusa. Yeah. Those of you who have done retreats, you know. Okay. Samantabhadra is part of the four great bodhisattvas in Mahayana Buddhism. In the Heart Sutra, it features Avalokiteshvara, which is the embodiment of compassion. And when I spoke on the Heart Sutra, I focused on the practice dimension of the Heart Sutra. And I introduced the practice of Avalokiteshvara. Remember that? I spent many talks on that. Samantabhadra represents the fulfillment of practice in the Bodhisattva path, which encompasses everything. Everything. I'll get to that part. Manjushri, Bodhisattva, represents wisdom. Wisdom of emptiness. And it's usually housed in the Chan or Zen hall in the monastery. He wields a sword, representing the sword of wisdom that cuts through ignorance. So also very important. And Kshitigarbha, or earth store Bodhisattva, represents great vows. This is a Bodhisattva that vows to reside in hell to save all beings. His vow is to empty all the residents of hell. Inexhaustible vow. And there are a couple of scriptures tied to that. But Samantabhadra is extremely important. All these four great bodhisattvas are very important, but we seldom hear about Samantabhadra. And I really want to introduce Samantabhadra to all of you. He is featured most prominently in the Avatamsaka Sutra, which outside of the Prajnaparamita genre of literature is the longest text. It's been translated 3 times in China into Chinese. 5th century, 7th century, and 8th century. 60 fascicles or scrolls, 80 scrolls, and 40 scrolls. Huge. And we're very fortunate because the 80 scroll version is translated into English already. It's about this thick. If you wish to have an afternoon reading, feel free to pick that up. Most prominently, and the last chapter of the Avatamsaka Sutra circulated independently as the Gandavyuha Sutra. This is the story of boy Sudana traveling like a spiritual pilgrimage, traveling to 110, over 100 cities, places, studying with 53 different bodhisattvas. And the story exemplifies the bodhisattva path. And Samantabhadra is the last bodhisattva after Manjushri. Manjushri sets him off on the path, and he sees all these great practitioners. And you don't think of practitioners like monastics. these practitioners range from monastics and lay, of course, but have a wide range of occupations, from butchers to children to prostitutes to great yogis, signifying the comprehensive, inconceivable realm of the Buddha, in which there are no hierarchies. First stage of bodhisattvahood is the last stage. Each and every one of these stages of practice encompasses the whole complete path. That is the view of the Avatamsaka Sutra, which is called the sudden and perfect view. Okay? This can only be found in Chinese Buddhism, and by extension, East Asian Buddhism, which is the third transmission of Buddhism. First one, South Asia, to Sri Lanka. Second to China, and third to Tibet. Fourth one would be to the West. Right? But the West is just, it's just beginning. Right? Nowhere in any other form of Buddhism is dependent origination, that is, the interfusion and interpenetration, interdependence of all things, fully fleshed out and elaborated. Yes, of course, the interdependence, dependent origination, pratityasamuppada, can be found in early Buddhism, can be found in general Mahayana Buddhism, different scriptures. But the full elaboration of that is only found in Chinese Buddhism. And all of you are privy to this language of interpenetration, interbeing, we're all connected. Where does that come from? That doesn't come from anywhere else in Buddhism. You may not know it. This language comes from Huayan Buddhism, Avatamsaka Sutra. If you look at early Buddhist teaching, the dependent origination teaching, at the core of which is samsara. That is, dependent origination based on an explanation of how samsara works. At the core of samsara, it's called a samsara chakra. At the core of samsara is three poisons: greed, hatred, ignorance. That's dependent origination based on klesha, vexations. But in later form of Buddhism, it taught dependent origination on the basis of consciousness. That is the Yogacara Buddhism, Alaya Vijnana, the eighth layer of consciousness, dependent origination, at the core of which is not klesha. Right? So the dependent origination based on klesha, three poisons, that fundamental Buddhism, basic Buddhism, Buddhism 101, early Mahayana, dependent origination based on the constructedness of reality of mind. That all things are actually constructed, simulated, fabricated through consciousness. And this has relevance to our time. In modern neuroscience, that what we are experiencing is actually a mental representation based on electrical signals, the neurosynaptic firing. Your brain has never left outside of your skull. It's just in pitch black darkness. How do you see? You think you see me. You think you touch. It's all electrical signals. What you see, Guo Gu, is your own mental construct of Guo Gu. And each of you see me differently. You live in your own world. It's not to say there are no world out there, but the world that you know it, that you feel, that you touch, can only be known through your mind. Does that make sense? Dependent origination. So all things are constructed, filtered, formulated, experienced, embodied through constructs. That's only beginning Mahayana. This is 2,000 years ago. Thousands of years ago. It's amazing. And then we have dependent origination based on Tathagata Garbha. Tathagata is an epithet of the Buddha. It's another name, honorific title for the Buddha. It's the teaching of Buddha nature. That all beings possess Buddha nature. This is an advanced teaching beyond the Yogacara and early Buddhism, which recognize some people are not able to be saved because they are called ichantikas. They lack virtuous karmic root. They are inferior beings. What? Buddhism recognize? Yes, early Buddhist teachings are like that. So dependent origination based on Tathagata Garbha, it's a more advanced, more profound teaching that recognizes Buddhahood in all beings. That all beings have this potential because all beings are already free. This freedom means their true nature. Their true nature is not limited by the containers, the labels, the words and construct that we infuse into them or we project onto them. You're not defined by any pronouns, labels, words, language. You're so much more than any label can ever encapsulate your full potential. And that full potential is your perfection in wisdom and compassion and your merit. On the basis of this view, one engages in practice. So the whole relationship with vexations, afflictions, struggles that we feel is completely different. If your view is based on there are three poisons within me, greed, hatred, ignorance, that I have to get rid of in order to reach nirvana, this is a view of polarization. I got to cut this off in order to get that. You see? If your view is based on the constructiveness of mind, a little bit better. Why? Because you stop victimizing yourself. Those jerks out there, sorry, they're your construct. Because if jerkhood is actually out there, everyone should feel the same. Because there's a reality, independently existent thingness out there that's called jerk. Everyone should experience the same thing then, if there's actually reality outside of your mind. Does that make sense? So the fact that you see as jerk and someone else see as their BFF, that's because you take ownership. Your habit tendencies, the way that your values are constructed, you're taught, your experience has shaped you into a particular way of seeing the world. So that's your world. It's like now, it's like people that watch Fox News, people that watch CNN, completely different realities. Each one perceive their world, their value in their shared experience and in their individual experience. They experience it very differently. So the teaching is, take up the responsibility for oneself and transform your mind from consciousness to wisdom. So the culprit is no longer outside. A little bit better. Dependent origination based on Tathagatagarbha. All beings are already free. Yes. Culprits is not outside, but they're still a culprit. My habit tendency, I gotta get rid of that, right? That's why the Tathagatagarbha dependent origination teaches that you're already free. On the basis of this freedom, you engage with your afflictions, struggles, vexations. They all can exist. In the spaciousness of this room, for example, of the mind, it can have clutter, it can have tidy and neat cushions, it can have dilapidated things, seemingly worthless, seemingly because nothing is worthless, seemingly beneficial, but from the spaciousness of this room, all furniture are accepted, are embraced. Therefore, a practitioner with this view engages in practice. How do you think they will relate to their own struggles and vexations and anger, hatred? It's all right. Engaging practice to transform them, yet don't make a big deal out of them. The practice is no longer based on getting rid of, losing, suppressing in order to get something. It's already here. So, vexations, obstacles become opportunities. You see? The early two teachings, obstacles are obstacles. You gotta get rid of them. The third dependent origination sees obstacles as opportunities. If you see obstacles as opportunities, how would you relate to them? More positive, right? So it diminishes the polarity within. Having, lacking, getting, losing, seeking, relinquishing, suppressing. It start to be free from that. Samsara is transformed into nirvana. So the views that govern your practice is very, very important. Very important. The final view. Avatamsaka. The view of Samantabhadra. Interpenetration. It's called dependent origination based on Dharma Dhatu. Dharma Dhatu is the realms of reality. In this teaching, it talks about tenfold realms. You have the six realms, human beings, demigods, the heavenly realms, and then the lower realms of animals, pretas, hungry spirits, insatiable greed, appetite. And denizens of hell. That's a typical six realms of existence. But on top of these six, there are four more realms. The realm of solitary realizers, Pratyeka Buddha. Those people who realize awakening by observing nature by themselves. They have no teachers. So that's one, Pratyeka Buddha. Second, Shravaka. Those beings who listen to the Buddha's teaching and realize liberation. Both of these categories are beings on the path of, whose view is that of getting rid of samsara in order to reach awakening. So that belongs to dependent origination based on klesha, karma. Dependent origination based on alaya, vijana, these two. Mainly the first one. So, Pratyeka Buddha, Shravaka, which is voice hearers, the Buddha's voice, and then Bodhisattva, Bodhisattva path. Beings who practice altruistic awakening for the sake of all beings, driven by compassion, shielded by wisdom, wisdom of equanimity, all beings, all obstacles, opportunities, all beings are teachers. And then the fourth one is the Buddha vehicle, the Buddha realm, what the Buddha sees, what the Buddha actually perceives. And the teaching of this is that all these tenfold realms or dharma dhatus actually interfuse with each one contains the rest of the nine, within the rest of the nine. And these ten realms interdepend, interpenetrate. So that's like saying all the living creatures, visible or invisible, inferior or superior, high or low, terrestrial or celestial, all of them are the Buddha path. So dependent origination based on this view of interpenetration, interdependence, interbeing, all beings are already free. Samantabhadra, Bodhisattva, is the embodiment of the Bodhisattva path from this view. Samantabhadra itself means universal good. Do you know what that means? IAG. It's all good. His name embodies the vision of the Buddha, the inconceivable realm. Now, our perception inevitably is sequential, it's always linear. Right. If we see this, then this is not that. If we see that, then that's different than this. What the Buddha, the complete, thorough awakening view is that all beings interdepend, interfuse. Within one, there's innumerous things. Like this table, in this table itself contains the whole universe. Right? Table is made up of non-table. Table is made up of all of these things, all the people that's involved, all the generations of engineers, inventions, designers, their parents, their ancestors, all of the knowledge of humanity. And this table in this moment is the basis of future designs of tables. So the future also exists here. It's like a grain of sand. Who says that? The Western literature person. William Blake. Yeah. The world is containing a grain of sand. It's kind of like that. So in this comprehensive view, when you see so-called obstructions that you have to transform to opportunities, which is the dependent origination based on Tathagata Garba, right? You still have to transform. In this view, seeing a sentient being, you see completely, comprehensively, the past, present, and future. In this moment, you may be experiencing wandering thoughts that may bog you down and just trapped in that container. But practice according to this view of Dharma Dhatu means in this moment of complete delusion is full awakening. A person who is practicing now, like each and every one of you, who's practicing now, you are the future Buddha. Now, can you imagine talking with someone and you're talking with the future Buddha? What would that relationship be like? Practitioners. And imagine if you see all beings from that, because dependent origination based on Tathagata Garba already said that all beings have Buddha nature. All beings have potential to become Buddha nature. That's like the third dependent origination view. This fourth one is like engaging with sentient beings. Yes, I mean all the politicians. I mean all the people who cause suffering. And all the benevolent rulers and the janitor and the Starbucks clerk that you see and the store clerk and your teachers and your children, seeing them as future Buddhas. That is Samantabhadra's practice. That kind of dependent origination, there is no gaining, no losing, no transforming from A to B, yet universally practice. Because Samantabhadra is the embodiment of practice. So all practitioners, based on that view, the interpenetration of the 10 realms, one of the realms is Bodhisattva, right? He's at the top. He already manifests as Buddhas, as a Buddha, okay? So based on that view, you are Samantabhadra. past, present, future collapses. Having, lacking, gaining, losing collapses. Yet, each and every sentient being, living being, in their own place, distinct. So the simultaneity of distinctness, yet fulfillment already complete. Inconceivable practice. Inconceivable. When we think linearly, we cannot fathom this. Table is not a chair. Chair is not rug. Rug is not a person. Sentient being is different than insentient objects. I'm practicing now, so in the future I can reach Buddhahood. I can reach awakening. From this dependent origination on the basis of Dharma Dhatu, that linear view is delusion. But the good news is delusion is awakening. Don't bog yourself down. I'm deluded. Oh, I can't do that. I'm not good enough. So all of a sudden, perfectly and instantaneously, we have to contain both views. You see? Recognizing that we are deluded, I do have vexations, limitations, yet at the same time, Samantabhadra. It's all good. Already present. A long time ago, I said that IAG, it's all good, is the highest teaching of Buddha Dharma. Remember that? Yeah. I never really unpacked that. Tonight, we unpack it. This is the view. So if you encounter Buddhism in a fragmented way, reading a little bit from here, a little book from here, watch a little video from here. These pieces of puzzle won't make sense. It's just fragmented. What I just presented from the core teaching of Buddha Dharma, dependent origination, on the basis of some teaching that centers around vexations, and from that perspective, you have to get rid of them so you can reach awakening. You can put it in that puzzle. Okay, this is the teaching of dependent origination based on klesha. Does that make sense? When you hear constructiveness of reality, put it in its right place. It's not confusing anymore. These teachings, from the ultimate perspective of Dharma Dhatu, it's all good. Even this teaching of, I gotta get rid of this in order to get that, it's fine, it's all good. Sentient beings practicing may not know it, but upon awakening, they realize it. So, it's just expedient means, skillful means to suit the particular nature of sentient beings. Why? Because sentient beings are still human beings, are still distinct. They have their particularities. They have their own history. Their own particular way of that they have constructed, limited themselves, put themselves in particular boxes, containers, with particular labels that resonates with them, that's meaningful for them. To them is very meaningful. So it's good for them. That's what they need. But as a person progress and practice, they realize that nothing can contain my true nature, the freedom that's within. You see? So, simultaneously, distinct, recognize the validity of all perspectives, all views. At the same time, being able to embrace them, the full capacity of them, where past, present, future collapses. If we only have the myopic vision of seeing this person, he's just a jerk, right? Just, he can't do it. Actually, every person goes through that process. I was telling Zoe tonight. We went to a pizzeria, and fortunately because it was a teaching moment. Unfortunately, they put too much red sauce and too much stuff on there. So as she ate the pizza, it's like dribbling all over. She was getting very annoyed. Because that person who did that is new on the job. Even his colleagues are making fun of him. And they put the sauce on, and the way he put up cheese, like, his colleague was like, "What are you doing, some magical trick?" "Just put the cheese on there." So he's like, you know, too much cheese, too much stuff, and he's making a mess. And Zoe's like, "Bro." Chill. And she's eating it, biting down, red sauce oozing out the sides. "Why is it?" I said, "Everyone go through that. He's just beginning. So in the beginning, you make a mistake. But after a while, he'll learn. He'll be quicker. Doesn't waste too much time. Cheese, it's all on there perfectly, you know." So from a linear perspective, myopic vision, we only see this person. Every one of us go through that. Every baby go through failures before they can learn how to walk. We can't just see sentient beings in terms of failure. Success is made up of failures. Learning how to walk is made up of falling down, where your legs are too weak. The little people, called babies, you know, their legs... Every one of you gone through that. Yeah? So recognizing the particularities at the same time encompassing the whole past, present, and future. This person is a Buddha. He will be the pizza king sometime as he keeps on making that pizza. You know? So questioning the containers that we habitually learned, that we limit ourselves and we try to contain other people in that container. Challenge that. You do recognize that some people need to be incarcerated to be educated. You recognize that, but you don't only see that. You also see the future. We're in correspondence with several prisoners. We have a whole group of, handful of letter writers, correspondents. One of them's here. Some of these practitioners in prison, I have to say they're pretty sincere. Dare I say, their practice is really deep, you know? They don't have the luxury that you have. They don't have the things you take for granted. So the Dharma, very precious to them. And while some of you say, I don't like precepts, Buddhist rules. I don't want to read. I just want to practice meditation. They are asking for precepts. You know? So, in the Lotus Sutra, there's a story of Bodhisattva never despise. He doesn't despise anyone. He sees all beings as embodiment of Buddha nature. That's that Bodhisattva's practice. So anyway, back to Samantabhadra. The Bodhisattva who embodies the Bodhisattva practices exemplify the ideal course of the Bodhisattva path. And this course is exemplified in Boy Sudana, in the Gandavyuha, the last chapter of the Avatamsaka, in the 40 fascicle version, Gandavyuha, entry to the realm of inconceivability. That is a story of Sudana, in which he exemplified Samantabhadra's. You could say Samantabhadra's inconceivable practice, because all practices, all methods, all sentient beings, all practitioners are Samantabhadra. You are Samantabhadra. When Sudana, Boy Sudana, practicing with all these 52 different great bodhisattvas, the final one, the last one, is Manjushri. But Manjushri just said, I'm so happy you learned all these things. Now, go study with Samantabhadra. So the last one. And when Boy Sudana saw Samantabhadra in that, sitting on top of the elephant with six different tusks, in that majestic form, he saw Samantabhadra's own practice. In that moment, he saw the past Samantabhadra, the present, and the attainment of Buddhahood of Samantabhadra, the translucent form. And then he saw himself, Sudana, himself, in Samantabhadra, in the past, present, and future. And then gaining inconceivable reality, which is an illustration of the interpenetration of all realms of existence. You see? Past, present, and future. Sudana realized he and Samantabhadra are inseparable. The final stage, just shy of Buddhahood, that revelation. Samantabhadra was him. And the past, present, future include all the different stages of practices and all the different realms that he has gone through. This means the six realms. The six realms of being, sometimes as an animal, sometimes as a praetor, hungry spirit, sometimes as this, and then going through all the different practices. So, so from the perspective of the Gandavyuha Sutra, in which, and the whole Avatamsaka Sutra, in which Samantabhadra is really prominently featured, the sojourn of practices of the Bodhisattva path includes every kinds of practice, both exoteric and esoteric practices. Samantabhadra also features in Tantric Buddhism. He is everywhere everything. In other words, shy of Buddhahood, and I'm not talking about seeing oneself nature realizing Buddhahood, that's like a little puny realization. I'm talking about full-on Buddhahood. Shy of that, everything is Samantabhadra. All who practices Dharma is Samantabhadra. You are Samantabhadra, manifesting in your form. See? And all the people that you see. Not distinguishing holy and profane. Challenging every container, every box, every construct that we have formulated to try to understand the world. They have helped us to navigate through the complexity of the world. We invented terms like, this is a friend, that is a foe, this is a jerk, this is a good person. That provides us with the illusion of some kind of management. These containers cannot possibly contain all the potential of every person. A jerk can be a friend. Like Boy Sudhana, studying with butchers. What? Butchers? Isn't that wrong livelihood? Of the Eightfold Path, butchers, prostitute, children with low intelligence, and yogis. Everyone becomes teachers. Everything interpenetrates. Everything reveals freedom. Every one of them has particular form, has particular container, has particular habit tendencies and realizations. So the distinctness is preserved, yet the vast inconceivability of time and space, where all labels are completely vanished. They also teach that, the Boy Sudhana. So practicing according to that view, there is no room for vexations. So when we encounter sentient beings, we bring that up. Who knows what this person will be? You know, when you were 5 years old, did you think you would be where you are now? No. Do you know where you will be in the future? You should know. You have to have the conviction. I will be a Buddha. But from the dependent origination based on Dharma Dhatu, I'm a Buddha here now. So, realizing Buddhahood in one lifetime, this is some cliche saying, it's not the invention of esoteric teaching or exoteric teaching. It's all here. It's Avatamsaka Sutra. Early. People think, oh, only Tantric Buddhism is the highest realm. Tantric Buddhism. Tibet didn't even have language in 7th century. They don't even have written language. The form of Buddhism that they receive, it's the last phase development in Indian Buddhism, but already contained in at least the 2nd century, 3rd century, already translated into Chinese from Indian Sanskrit text. It's already there. Already there. Right? So, recognizing that Samantabhadra is none other than ourselves. It's extremely important from the perfect and sudden view of practice. Yuan dun, perfect and sudden view. That is the correct view. That is the view of the Buddhas. So engaging practice based on that view, you plant the seed of full Buddhahood. You don't plant the seed of just a Shravaka, Pratyeka Buddha. Does that make sense? And what is that view? What is Samantabhadra? Samantabhadra represents all virtue, all practices. He is the path. Shy of full Buddhahood, every stages of practice, every methods of practice, it's Samantabhadra, are born out of Samantabhadra. He is the path. He's the fulfillment of Buddhahood. He is the causal ground. And when I say he, I don't mean a gendered he, non-gendered. Right? Samantabhadra. In every moment, past, present, and future. Now, when this sutra entered into China, beginning in 2nd, 3rd century, there have been fragmented dozens of translations of the Avatamsaka Sutra in fragmentary parts. First full translation, 5th century, and then 7th century, and then 8th century again. But the formulation on the basis of these teachings, what is actually said in the scriptures, gave birth to Huayan Buddhism, Tiantai Buddhism and Huayan Buddhism, both. Because in chapter 28 of the Lotus Sutra, Samantabhadra is also featured. That's the last chapter. Samantabhadra promises, because he is the path, he is the Bodhisattva path. Okay? He promises the Buddha, anyone who reads, recites, upholds, and practices the Lotus Sutra, Samantabhadra will manifest before this person, visibly or invisibly, help this person to fulfill Buddhahood. And in that chapter, chapter 29, you will see he mentions a particular practice. He says, if sentient beings can uphold the Lotus Sutra, read, recite, uphold, and practice these four things for 21 days. 21 days. That's 3 7 days. With single-mindedness, I will manifest before this practitioner and help this practitioner fulfill, strengthen, and deepen their practice. That's not a Chinese invention. This Lotus Sutra translated in Sanskrit, Bhutanese, Chinese, and all these different versions. Right? On the basis of this, sometime in the 6th, 7th century, Master Zhiyi developed an intensive retreat practice called half-sitting, half-non-sitting practice. He called it the Lotus Repentance Practice. I want to introduce you to the Lotus Repentance Practice. So this is a practice of 21 days. A person engages in this practice by himself or herself, supported by community. They prepare the food, they support this person to enter into a retreat. And this retreat is basically divided into two halves. Half sitting and half non-sitting. The non-sitting basically entails circumambulation, walking, slow walking in circular clockwise direction. In the center is an altar. There's no Buddha images, just the Lotus Sutra. And as this person walks, they will recite the Lotus Sutra, read it, supposedly. Read the Lotus Sutra. They say, do very slow walking meditation. And the practice is alternating. Right? It doesn't detail how long you should do sitting, how long you should do non-sitting. It can fluctuate according to the needs of the practitioner, but basically, continuously practice like this way. Besides eating, toiletry, and going to the toilet, and so on. Basically, the person is in this solitary retreat. As they read, this is what the person is supposed to do. This is my translation. Clarify your voice, not too fast, not too slow. The voice of your own chanting, at the same time that you're reading this. Contemplate your voice like echoes in the empty valley. Although the sound is empty, the mind illuminates the meaning of the lines, the words, in utter clarity. That means the simultaneous perception of the function of chanting and yet the voicing, it's like echoes in this vacuous space. And allowing this chanting voice to permeate throughout the 10 directions. Like making an offering of the Dharma of the Lotus Sutra to all sentient beings in the 10 directions. Everywhere. Causing them to enter, give rise to bodhicitta, altruistic mind of awakening, through compassion, benefiting them. So that's how you're supposed to do the chanting, like that. And as you're sitting, the mind of sitting, right? For example, when you sit, you know how you can direct your mind to the breath, right? Or you can feel relaxed in the body. That directionality of the mind, that embodied experience in the mind, sinking the weight down, and you can follow that. Isn't that right? that's like the voice of chanting, and yet in empty, vacuous echo space. It's like echoes in space. The voice doesn't really exist. It's insubstantial. Yet you can hear it. You can understand it. Right? Just like the forms that you see. Right? It's your mental representation. It's your own construct. Yet you can see it. It's empty, yet not empty. So as you direct the mind in meditation, ultimately find that the mind itself cannot be apprehended. Like for example, place your awareness now, let the center of gravity, exhale, sink down to your buttocks. And you feel the tactile sensation at the buttocks. Can you do that? Right. You feel that there, right? What is this mind? What is this mind that just dropped in to the buttocks? The sense of groundedness. Is it substantial? There's a physicality to it, meaning there's an embodied experiencing of groundedness. Yet, where is it? Where is this mind? Insubstantial, like a dream, like an illusion or magic. Being quiescent, it is like empty space. It is without name, without distinguishing characteristics. Yet, it defies discrimination. At this point, the practitioner does not even see the mind of birth and death. For example, birth and death. What is birth and death? Rising and falling. Birth of a wandering thought and vanishing of a wandering thought. Right? You watch a thought arise. Where is it? Where did it just go? Is there such a thing as rising and ceasing? That's what it's saying. The practitioner does not even see the mind of birth and death. How could the practitioner expect to find the mind of nirvana? The mind of samsara, the mind of nirvana. What's that? As he does not apprehend any object of discernment or retain any notions of a subjective discerner, you may feel you are aware. What is this you? Where is it? Where is this you in the mind? Because you cannot discern a witnesser, an experiencer. Thoughts happen by themselves without a thinker. Cannot hold on to anything. Does not abandon anything. Does not depend on anything. And does not adhere, lean on anything. No mental activities arise. The mind is ever quiescent, yet does not dwell in stillness, quiescent. It's not that nothing is there, nor can you say something is there. Beyond the reach of words, language, unfathomable, indescribable. That is the meditation component of the lotus repentance. And that truth of the merging of form and emptiness, to use the language of Prajnaparamita, the Heart Sutra, the inseparability of that sounds like an echo. Echo. As if there, as if not there. This is the analogy. Like the clouds. As if there, obviously there are sea clouds, but as if not there. Substantial yet insubstantial. All phenomenal realities are actually like that. But I see concreteness. Yes, but that's your fabrication. But I feel it. Seeing is believing, Descartes says. Actually, your seeing is just your own mental construct. You created it. What are you actually seeing? What if there's a lesion in your neurological visual cortex pathway that makes you start to see illusions? Is it there? Sometimes we see illusions, right? Is it there or is it not there? How different is it, the illusion, hallucinations, from actually seeing? I don't think there's a difference from the perspective of your mind. It's just different synaptic combination firings. So one makes one more real than the other. As if there, as if not there. Not denying the reality of this moment, yet no containers can fathom, pinpoint, pigeonhole into a specific container. This is just a jerk. It's so many things. Samantabhadra, which is universal good, which is, it's all good. That's what's saying. That's why it's all good. It's all good, IAG, does not mean you're delusional and everything is good. You're just brainwashing yourself, ignoring the specificity, particularity of phenomena. But you're not bound by that. In this particular space and time, this dot, point, it may have this feature, but in this particular manifestation, it also contains the past and the future and the eventual fulfillment of that being's Buddhahood. It's all good. Delusion will give rise to resourcefulness. Resolution. You know? Difficulties, obstructions give rise to opportunity. The swinging of our politics, they mutually interfuse, they give rise to each other. One candidate, first 8 years, give rise to the next president. The whole world is collapsing. Yes, only if you see it from this particular angle, this point in time. It's not denied, but in this very moment, Samantabhadra manifest future is there. Because without that, it won't give rise to the next thing. Right? How many of you have seen the movie, Avengers or something? Avenger, like those superheroes, right? Like they travel back in time. The key thing of travel back in time, you all know from Hollywood, is you can't change the past. God, if you change the past, then something else will just completely change.
I want to go back and give it to Hitler.
Yeah, Hitler. We don't know what's going to happen if we just kill Hitler when he was a baby. When he's a baby, how many of you like babies? Right? You see a baby, it's all so adorable. That's the future Hitler. Oh my gosh. So adorable. How can possibly this being massacre, genocide? No idea. And yet because of that, we've advanced. We know what not to do. We know what not to do. We've garnered resourcefulness of helping beings, of reconciling. We don't suppress the past. If you go to Germany now, it's very visible. They don't deny their past. And they teach about it in school. Yeah. Some countries don't do this. If they do something crappy, they tuck it underneath the rug. They teach it in school. This is what we have done. This is what will make us to do better. It shows us that we can do better. Not concealing, revealing. Exposing. Embracing it. Then we can transform. Then we can let go. See the things that I taught before? The fourfold process. Exposing. Don't tuck it away. Don't conceal it. Exposing, then you can embrace. Embracing, you can transform. Transforming, you can let go. You can't let go if you don't accept it's you. You did this. We did this. Right, so, all beings, Samantabhadra. This is a non-linear view. This is a non-discriminatory view. That's what I say. No discrimination. That's the view of Dharmadhatu. So in practice, don't deny, suppress, and be able to see, allow it to be. The particularities of our vexations has distinct features. But those features, you don't say, well, vexations is actually wisdom, liberation, so I'm just going to eat as many chocolate as I can. I'm going to kill as many people as I can. I'm going to step over everyone, do what that's just stupidity. That's delusion. Right? Because that's driven by greed, hatred, ignorance. Right? So you're driven by compassion as you recognize this within. Transform without reification of I am no good, I am bad, this is my container, I'm just this person. You're so much more than any label you can put yourself. See? And yet you engage in practice. Recognize the need of labels, of containers, to particular circumstances, and yet at the same time, collapsing past, present, and future, already free. That's why it's all good. You see? That's why it's all good is the highest teaching of Buddha Dharma. And that's why we need to talk about this. What is Samantabhadra, universal good bodhisattva? What does this bodhisattva represent in terms of the ground, the path, the full fruition of Buddhahood? And in that context, we can understand the 10 great vows of Samantabhadra, which are not only vows, that is his practice. Bhadracharya Pranidhana. Bhadra, Samantabhadracharya. So literally translated is the practice and vows of Samantabhadra. That's what we chant. I'll mention these 10 and we'll continue with the first one next time. And next time, we've changed our schedule so that Monday night talks is every other week. Instead of once a week, it's every other week, so we can cover a lot of bases. Right. First vow, first practice is to worship and respect all Buddhas. Now, in this context, who are the Buddhas? All beings. Oh, that Buddha, yeah, I'm just worshiping a plastic, a piece of wood, or some copper. No, no. From the Samantabhadra perspective of tenfold Dharma Dhatus, interfusion, interpenetrating, all beings are Buddhas. Worship and respect all beings. We'll get to that. Second, to praise the Tathagatas, the thus come one. Just put that. Third, to cultivate the giving of offerings. The fourth, to repent all karmic obstructions. It's not to say there's no karmic obstructions. Repent for them. Yet, it's all good. Have to have that view. Fifth, to rejoice in the merits of others. The sixth, to request the turning of the Dharma wheel. The seventh, to request that the Buddhas dwell in the world. The eighth, to always follow the Buddhas in study. The ninth, to always harmonize with sentient beings. The tenth, to transfer all merit and virtue to all beings, to all others. That's the Bhadracharya Pranidhana, Samantabhadra's practice and vows. Each talk will cover one vow, flesh it out. Okay, any questions?